This one says freedom, kind of freedom off the, man, off the conditions and off the contradiction in relationship to the housing and what the housing situation looks like, and in relationship to money, 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 other kinds of freedom, psychological attack, freedom. This one here, this next one, is when we used to go to the housing. We used to go to the, we used to work in the projects up there on 66 when off of 8th International Way. We used to go on there and work with the community in there. And we used to go to, we had congregation, we used to go to the city council meetings in relationship to what was issue and what their demands were, what they were complaining about. And so around, I did a strip called Public Housing USA, and I can't read it because it's so small in here, but it was talking about the you know, housing, having rats in the house, insects in the house, bad stairs, kids couldn't play outside, being harassed by the police, no bad tummy, all those kinds of things was the what these cartoon strips were about. And this one was when Richard Nixon coined the word black capitalism, we said that if he coined black capitalism, they ain't worth nothing. You know, if the U.S. appearance is a tree, black capitalism is a weed. And if you chop down a tree, you gonna squash black capitalism. And the guy said, well, what are you talking about? And so that's what was being illustrated here in the context, because he was the one. It was his administration that coined the word black capitalism. Now this one here is Bill Boyette, who owns the liquor store on 55th and International Way. Huey and Newton know them. And what happened is that they were out at this, used to be on 55th or 65th and Telegraph, used to be a big supermarket around in that area. And they were out boycotting. And Huey drove by and they seen them and asked them. And they said, well, at that time, they didn't have no liquor distributors, black liquor distributors. And they were trying to get a black liquor distributor's license. So Huey explained that, well, we will help you with the boycott if you make a donation to the Black Panther Party Community Survival Programs. So what we did is we took to pick it over. When people started saying, let's take it over, and they knew who we were, most of them stopped going to the store, except for those who were elder and couldn't afford to go anyplace else. And so we came back and analyzed that situation, and we said we were gonna make them a proposal. And we were gonna make the proposal was that we were gonna get all the cars and all the transportation we could. We were gonna bring it up to the store, and we would take them to any store that they wanted to go to in Oakland, some of them, and bring them back to another location, some of them they didn't go in there. They agreed to that. We shut them down in 3 days. Shut them down. Then Bill Boyette, they got the liquor license. But Bill Boyette being slick, he didn't want, he said, I ain't gonna make it, y'all. We said, okay, we're gonna boycott you. We're gonna boycott you. And he was part of CalPAC, which is this black liquor distributors group, who started giving scholarships away later on and what have you. And they were saying, well, man, you need to donate. Well, yeah, no. Because he's hustling that. It's slick. And so we had a picket line, and this went on for 6 months, in front of his store from 6 a.m. in the morning to 2 a.m. the next morning when it closed. And we had Bill Boyette, we love you. We know you're a victim too. All these things, protesting out front. You had black people who first came by, wondering how, why we were boycotting another black business. But when we explained it to them, they got on the picket line. And the picket line grew, and we had shifts where people came in from 6 in the morning to work to 9. You had another shift come in from 9 to 1, and from 1 to 4, and 4, and all the way through on a daily basis. There used to be a whole parking, a whole lot next to it before they built it up. We had a rally there, gave free food bags of food to give away, talked about the boycott. The only way he stayed open was you had the white Chamber of Commerce of Oakland, because they had no blacks in it, and they didn't like us. They bankrolled him for 6 months, along with William Nolan, who owned the Oakland Tribune then. Mm-hmm. They the ones bankrolled him because nobody was going into the store. And so we did this whole kinds of cartoons with him and William Nolan during that period. And it was after 6 months of negotiation went on, it was then Assemblyman Ron Dellums who came in and negotiated the settlement. And at the end of it, I did a grocery bag, and with a sister with a grocery bag, and it said, Bill Boyette supports the Community Survival Program, support Bill Boyette. Because the all boycott was over, it wasn't personal, it was about the fact of him keeping his agreement. But what are you supposed to do? And so when that did, that brought about the solidarity and support, you see? And so that's what it was. But all of that came, another thing that Huey and Bobby talked about, was that they weren't about doing nothing at all. There was just these, they weren't about doing nothing. But out of that, they began to see a raise of consciousness, even though it was opposed to us, they began to give scholarships away. They began to do things in relationship to helping the community in their context of what they could do. But it was to give major scholarships away at one point. But they weren't doing nothing before that. And it went on for 6 months. And this one says, Bill Boyette, blank bug blood bank, where particular people congregate. And it was a collage of young people and stuff in the bottle with him and over there on the east side. Here again was another one. Said bottled by Nolan, sold by Boyette. And this is a class brothers. It has Nolan as a clan. So and it is, hey, I'm a greedy man. He ain't over the whole bundle of money. Yeah. So we was on it. Yeah. Scrooge. And this is the one where we did with his picture, the last one after the seven. It said Bill Boyette on the bag with his picture. And Bill Boyette supports the community survival program, support Bill Boyette. So this is like solidarity. I'm gonna go on to some other ones pretty soon. But this is just on father, son, love, and determination. This was about Alabama, Mississippi, Chicago, U.S. Freedom is a constant struggle kind of issue there. This is about justice. This one here is about freedom. I got freedom on my mind. I just want to testify. I got freedom on my mind. Here again, this is about the church. What we used to deal with churches. And some of them, we call them bootlickers and out of town and fell out because some of them weren't doing what they're supposed to do. And we had some who were dealing with liberation theology and what have you. And so this is when we mended those differences and it shows, and it just says coming together for freedom and what have you. And matter of fact, the first breakfast program we had was out of Father Earl Neal, was black Presbyterian minister on 27th and West. Ruth Beckford, who used to be the dancer with Dorothy Donovan, suggested that we have the breakfast program out there. Ruth Beckford was a part of, a lot of people didn't know, the Panther had an advisory list of people who they used to communicate with, black, middle-class blacks. Ruth Beckford was on that list. Reverend Pinkett, Bishop Pinkett now, who was on that list, who was good friend of Huey. Lionel Wilson, the first black mayor of Oakland, California, all these people were part of the list that Huey and them used to talk with. John George, the first black supervisor, he was the Black Panther first lawyer. We helped him get elected as the first supervisor of Oakland, California. He acknowledges that. Same thing with Lionel Wilson. He acknowledges that he could not have never been elected if it wouldn't have been for the Black Panther Party bringing in and helping him in the context of that. In that relationship. And what happened is that you had the Democratic Party. When they came to us, and I had to be at the office when this happened, and this guy came to the office and he showed a list of these black judges they wanted to propose to elect as judges. And they showed the list to us to get our approval. And they said, we said, yeah, they'd be good. We didn't think they were gonna help us. We said they'd be good for the community. And sure enough, they got the judgeships. You have Brother Sweeney, the one who died not too long ago. He was one of those. They acknowledged him. even those judges, they acknowledged that if it wouldn't been for the Panthers, they wouldn't have got the judgeship. It's what Swinney used to do. We had a sister named Regina who had a healthy babies program where she should send, but they used to send girls, young ladies, who were going into the prison system, the last chance, he would send them to their program instead of sending them to prison. So you see how that worked? It's just, that's what it, how it worked. This says, we shall survive without a doubt. I'm going to go a little fast again. Here, we want to talk about survival, pending revolution. We had free busing prison programs where we used to take loved ones of those who were incarcerated to visit loved ones in prison across the country. In Chicago, they had to give them a Greyhound bus. They took the Greyhound off, put a Panther on it, and called it the free bus to prison program. We got actual photographs of all this. Actual photographs of this whole documentary as well. You had in the South, Winston-Salem, the first chapter of the Black Panther Party in the South was in Winston-Salem. They couldn't get the ambulance and then come into the community. So the Panthers went and got certified as ambulance drivers, and the community helped them buy an ambulance. So we had the Black Panther Party ambulance service in Winston-Salem. And we had people's health clinics all across the country. We had doctors and nurses and lawyers who come in, and we had actual assistance, help with the had basic kinds of prescriptions and stuff that people could get. We did sickle cell anemia testing, because you had some hustlers when we first seen it, we were taking over, ripping the people off. We pushed that out the way. We took it over with doctors and stuff, with the testing. We did over 100 free tests, over 100,000 free testing across the country of sickle cell anemia. You had a Panther who was in the party, who was ill for many years, didn't even realize what was happening until he took the prick test and took the blood and found out he had sickle cell anemia. That's how he found out. So this was a program that we did called sickle cell anemia, fight sickle cell anemia. We said vote for survival. We said people's free food program. Talk about that. Keep going a little bit. Shirley Chisholm, vote for Shirley Chisholm. Vote for survival. They talk about Hillary Clinton being the first woman to run for president. Shirley Chisholm was the first woman to run. Black woman, she ran for president. We supported her. She came out here and we held rallies for her during that time. They tried to marginalize her, saying that she was taking big strokes from the mainstream candidates, and they tried to put her on the peripheral. But we supported her during that time. This says all power to the people who made it. You can see the collage in the background of free nursing program, the free health food, all those kinds of things. Here again, this one here, it talks about fight sickle cell anemia with pictures on the book itself, showing actual testing and stuff like that going on. Here's a front page of the Black Panther paper saying Black genocide, sickle cell anemia. Then we talked also about the 1939-1940, when you had these black sharecroppers who they couldn't read or write. They gave $50 to be in this program to test them for syphilis. They took the money and they went into the test. In 1947, they found a cure for syphilis. This was called the Tuskegee experiment. Again, they took the money, but when they found the cure in 1947, which was penicillin, they didn't give it to them. They just kept them in the study. They became ill, became sick, passing on loved ones, going blind. In 1972, there was some investigative reporters who really couldn't get the stuff published in the mainstream paper. So they started giving it to alternative press, such as the Black Panther Party and other papers. And when we published it along with the other alternative press, that's when the study stopped, in 1972. And this was a government experiment. This is about safe seniors in spiritual environment. We had a senior program, safe program, where I was, we should take, pick up seniors from their satellite houses and take them shopping, take them to the bank, cash their checks. All this during that time. When we had our school, the Oakland Community School, became the culture center in the evening. The seniors used to come there and they used to do programs, senior programs, the whole that happened. But I did this image because of the fact that this time, Oakland was talking about spending $54,000 on a helicopter, patrol the community and talk about fighting crime. And we was pointing out that if you really want to stop crime, you take that $54,000 and you invest it in young people to take the senior shot. Take them to cash the check. If you really talk about stopping crime and not no helicopter and nothing to help these youngsters and stuff out here, out of, you know, on a daily basis, they ain't gonna deal with crime. This is called Today's News, question mark. This one says, hypertension killed. I'm hungry. I'm unemployed. I'm black. This is about the housing then, the housing now. It says, I have no money, but I have no money for sale. Urban redevelopment. Can't read that. This one here was about apartheid in South Africa. Actually can't see it that well, but also did work around the apartheid system in South Africa. So we were opposed to the apartheid system in South Africa. We did illustrations around it. Now here's artwork that was done by the Cuban arch. That was my work there. That they should pick up some of the images I did, bring in some of these amazing cultures and send them all over the world. Called OSPAL, you can see them online, Organization of Solidarity with people from Asia, Africa, and Latin America. And what happened is that a lot of times when the people, youngsters used to go there to work in the sugar cane brigades to help and the ones in the season. They used to see this artwork, and they used to come back, some of them who knew, were politically aware of the work, used to say, you didn't do that work, we seen that in Cuba. So about the same time, they thought that I was copying the Cuban work, when the Cubans were copying the work that I did. And to show you, see those two images there? That's where the work comes from. Show you, see? If you see this image in the back, that one in the front, they just put their thing on them, and they combined the two images and brought it together. And did the amazing poster. This was another one that they did, the next one. In four languages, where they took this artwork. This is how we knew they was reading the paper, because it was in the interior of the paper. It was just a small art piece of artwork in the interior of the paper. And they made this amazing poster that said, Solidarity with African American People, August 18, 1968, in Spanish, I think, four different languages. And here's the actual artwork that they used. It was black and white. They flipped it, made it into this amazing artwork. Also, here's another one of the works that I did, Afro-American Solidarity with the Oppressed People of the World. Then it was talking about the corporate America. This one says, I, Gerald Ford, am the 38th puppet of the United States. That's when he was made president, showing all the corporate hand puppet that controlled everybody in society. Everybody knows that now. You know, back then, people weren't inclined to understand what was going on. And then came Halloween, and on Halloween they just, I said, let me do this one. I did this one called Trick or Treat Pig, Trick or Treat. You got Ben in the eye of the pumpkin, you got Richard Nixon in one, and then you got Spiral Agnew in the other. The president and the vice president of the United States were both criminals. Both had to leave the government in disgrace. They had to leave in disgrace. One in disgrace. And this here is called Conspiracy to Destroy the Black Panther Party. This is when we got documents on the COINTELPRO and the counterintelligence program. They're kind of showing that there. This one here says, I wonder if Nixon is bugging us now. And then also, what I want to say, I wonder if Dennis said Trump is spying on us now. And in part of that, I wonder if Obama is spying on us now, with all marked out as well. Because what you have, you have to understand that they have a, they got a secret court that they can go to, called a FISA court. That's the federal secret something court, where they can get an order to spy, and you don't even know it. You know, they got judges who they pick to be on that from the Supreme Court, to be on that, the judges. Two or three of them have to live in the District of Columbia, but they can pick up from other than that. They've only turned down about, out of hundreds of requests, maybe four or five or six, but I think just because they had to be rewritten or reworded. And when the president who was cooled out in Brazil came to the United States, and Obama said that we not spied on nobody, we ain't never spied on nobody, and then it came out that they had been spying on us since 2010. Screw you, brother. Then I did one of the next class brothers had Nixon and Hitler as the same. Then I also did one of, again with Nixon, wanted to be King Nixon. We had the expense spending, corporate spending going up, and the plan in the front. Then I just kind of retested it again and put Trump in there. Then I got this one here. So it says, we are soldiers in the army. We have to fight, although we have to die. We have to hold up a blood-stained banner. We got to hold up until we die. My father, he was a soldier. He had his hand in the freedom flag. And when he got old and couldn't fight anymore, he said, we got to get up and fight anyhow. My mother, she was a soldier. She had her hand in the freedom flag. When she got old and couldn't fight anymore, she said, we got to get up and fight anyhow. Now, with all our soldiers, we have our hand. When we get old and can't fight anymore, we got to get up and fight anyhow. This is again cautious, surviving this criminal. Then we talk about the prison camps USA, the unknown slaves. Then you talk about the prison industrial complex. When we talk about prison industrial complex, we talk about profit, money, and making profit, and privatization of prisons. So that means if you're in the privatization of prison, that means that you're going to have a product to make money. So that means if you ain't got enough product on your shelf to make money, you're going to try to make sure you do have enough product on your shelf to make money. So that means that in the context of human beings being that product, it will always be those who are incarcerated should not be incarcerated. Here again is why must black people look at each other through prison bars, where is my freedom? Brothers and maybe in maximum security, those families who are linked to the brothers and sisters who are incarcerated are also psychologically in minimum security. This one says, my suffering, my bitterness, my loneliness, I'm not going to let it get me down. I'm not going to let it turn me around. There's perhaps a young man who was expressing his feelings about concern and family locked up. And I was learning how to integrate words and collages into the art, give more meaning to the artwork, and how to phrase it after a while, after I did artwork, how to let want to say what sometimes, those kinds of things. This is about George Jackson Hills. George Jackson was a brother who well famous known, but he was a common criminal when he went to prison. But we got enlightened, informed, and became politicized in the prison system. When he was in prison and when Huey got shot, and they sent him to San Quentin Hospital, he told them to watch out for Huey, but also he sent the word that he wanted to join the Panthers. And that's how the first chapter in prison got started. Black Panther Party prison chapter got started was in San Quentin prison. Then Fred Hampton, Mark Clark, murdered Fred Hampton. Most may be familiar with that. You can see it online, respecting. And then that plays back to when I talked earlier about the when they began to infiltrate the party with Agent Provocateurs. A young man who set Fred them up and stole a car, took them across state lines, had a federal case, told them if he infiltrated the Black Panther Party, they'd deal with him. And that's what he did. That's how Fred was set up in Chicago, in Mark. And the good thing about it, on Iron Brides, when they first did it, this next year around, he came out and he acknowledged that on Iron Brides. So a lot of people were saying it, but didn't want to believe that that could happen. But then he confessed to it on the Iron Brides series. But then he committed suicide. He ran out on a car on the highway, walked in front of the car. This is why I did my tribute. Carl Hampton, no kin to Fred Hampton. He was the head of the Black Panther chapter in Houston, called People's Party 2. We missed at first because we had shut down and was not letting any open up new any chapters. But he loved parties, so he called it People's Party 2. Eventually became the Black Panther Party, Houston chapter. They had cleaned up the neighborhood, prostitution, drugs. Elders would go out in the streets the whole bit. They had gotten an altercation, a verbal altercation with the Houston police. A couple of weeks later, they came back, and somebody told him that police was out there. He went out to see what was happening, and they had allowed the police to go up in the church tower, sniped him. And when he went out to see, the police sniped him, killed him from a church tower. And Houston had a similar situation in New Orleans, where he had the sister who they knocked on the door, just the priests and nuns, knocked on the door. She asked who it was and said, and they shot through the door. Mm. But she survived. So this kind of tells you what was going on. He was sis. Huey Newton by himself and beat and kind of contemporary time were initially the first political prisoners in the USA.
Why you say that?
Mm-hmm.
You said why you said it was the first political prison?
In contemporary times, and this in the period of Black Panther Party. Because they were some of the first who were incarcerated, where there was a lot of political protests and demonstrations around it and the whole bit. Yes. Now here you have Romaine Chip Fitzgerald, brother who's been locked up over 45 years now. From L.A. Little prisoner. He was free New York 21. That was one of the first. That's when they began to really try to destroy the party by getting us locked up and caught up in these courts. The money that we were using for the survival programs. We now got to work also to raise money for these political prisoners and people that are incarcerated. So all that became a part of the reality that we had to deal with.
Hold on, talk about Pac Mama.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Tupac, finish your court. You got to finish your court. That's right. Maybe, you know, that was a happen in the New York chapter of the Black Panther Party.
She was a leader, right?
Or she was one of the leaders, yes. There were many leaders. Okay. It wasn't just a leader, there were many.
She was many, yeah. But she was in that case right there, right?
Yeah, she won in New York 21, yes. Free Anderson Davis, we also were in solidarity. Maybe she wasn't necessarily in the party, but she was in solidarity with the party during that time. And she acknowledged that she came back to the U.S. because of the fact that when the Panther kicked out, she seen it on the news and wanted to come back for that purpose. This is called Kidnap. That was when we used to have our central headquarters up right across the street from La Pena, where the law office is. We came to the office one day to figure out, we knew something was happening. We knew something was happening, but we didn't know what it was. And we could just sense, because we always observed that evening we left in two cars. Bobby Sill was in one car. We went to the filling station up there on the corner of Ashby and Shattuck. And all of a sudden you had the federal marshals shoot down on us with automatic weapons and what happened. Snatched Bobby out of the car, took him off. And we called our lawyer to find out what was going on. They took him to the federal building in San Francisco, was taking him back to Chicago because he had been invited to speak in protest against the war in Vietnam and what was happening at the Democratic Convention outside. So they were trying to charge him with inciting to riot, and which was not the case. So that's why they shipped him back while he was there. And so while he was there, he went to court. And he was in court. He was gagged in court, living history. First time that she ever had a person gagged in court because of the fact that he wanted to defend himself when his lawyer had a, minor operation and was not going to be there. And he wanted to defend himself. They refused to allow him to do that. So they